I'm honored to be with you today. The event we did in 2008, I think, was one of the best panels done at the Democratic National Convention. The panelists were equally esteemed as the ones we have here today. Not only did I enjoy it, but I think that the audience got a lot out of it as well. So what we're gonna do is, I'm gonna first start by introducing the panelists. We'll talk for about an hour, and then we'll take questions. You can, when we do the questions, you can either direct them to specific people, or you can just ask ask general questions. Let me start on the other end. Ed Rollins is a political commentator, a Republican campaign strategist for President Ronald Reagan, and presidential candidate Ross Perot, among many others. Doug Schoen is a political polling and campaign strategist for the Clinton-Gore and Bloomberg campaigns. He works for many companies now as well. Jane Hampshire is the founder and publisher of one of the top political blogs in the nation, the progressive Fire Dog Lake. She's also a film producer and author. Next to her is Carl Bernstein, the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist and author who has written many books, including his most recent biography, A Woman in Charge, The Life of Hillary Rodham Clinton. Jonathan Capehart is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist who is now editorial writer for The Washington Post on national politics. Next to him is Katrina Vandenhoevel, who's editor, publisher of The Nation, and also a political commentator who appears on many of the television networks. Next to her, Matthew Dowd, commentator for ABC News and columnist for National Journal, former campaign strategist for President George Bush. And finally, next to me is Steve Hildebrand, a Democratic political strategist, former deputy national campaign director for Barack Obama's 2008 presidential campaign. So welcome to all of you, and thank you very much for doing this. Let's start with an issue that has, we want to talk, obviously we're going to focus on the midterms here, and an issue we keep hearing about again and again is the impact of the Tea Party. It relates to an issue which we'll talk about later, which is voter anger, but I want to specifically talk about the Tea Party. And Doug Schoen, let me start with you. As someone who evaluates the impact of these sorts of things, in the end, is the Tea Party movement going to help the Republicans or hurt? Because on the one hand, you have people saying, well, they're this fringe group, there are people getting elected who are never going to win. And on the other hand, you have a group of people who are committed and who are going to show up at the poll.
You know, Dan, two quick points, and then I'll answer your question. First, having written a book to assess the Tea Parties, the reaction from many people has been, how could you write about them? They're so horrible. And my point in saying that is we've become so polarized as a people and a country that if you try to do analysis of something that may not be your view, it's certainly not my worldview what they represent, you are subject to question. That's sort of point one. And point two, 2 years ago at this time, if you asked that question, people would have gone, huh? What? What are you talking about? There wasn't a Tea Party. That being said, let me give a concise answer because we've got a lot of people and I'm sure there'll be a diversity of views. First, I think they're the most important movement in American politics today, as important as the Democratic or Republican parties as entities. I think the enthusiasm that they've generated, which was the last part of your question, pales in comparison to some of the people who've been nominated. And what I would say in terms of those who've been nominated, you wouldn't want to blame the movement for the people who have necessarily become their standard bearers. That is, I don't think Sharon Angle or Rand Paul necessarily represent the best of the values that undergird the Tea Party movement, but it is a statistical fact of life that we've seen in states like Colorado, Alaska, Nevada, Kentucky, Florida, that extraordinary impact in the Republican primaries, and now I believe on Election Day, the enthusiasm gap is in large part explainable by the Tea Party movement. I think the Wall Street Journal poll said about a third of the voters who are going to turn out on Election Day are estimated to be Tea Party supporters. So I think the benefit to the Republican Party vastly exceeds the deleterious impact from having fringe candidates or potentially fringe ideas. And I think it is a sign and representative of the anger that exists in the electorate that there is a Tea Party movement, Ed Rollins can take you back, if you'd like, to 1992. But in 92, when there was a similar outpouring of support for Ross Perot, it was seen as a mainstream movement to get the budget, the deficit, and the debt under control. It's the same and more now.
And I'm going to get to Ed in a moment. But Jane, let me just ask you, do you see it as something progressive that you embrace? Do you say, this is great. We love having a villain. We love having something to beat up on. We think this galvanizes our base as well.
Say it's, you know, that's a very it's a complex question. Originally, the Tea Party sort of came around as a manufactured event. Fox News, FreedomWorks, Americans for Prosperity, you know, all this money came into organizing these rallies all across the country in April of 2009. And it was very much the Republican Party's attempt to reinvent themselves after George Bush. But what happened over time was that the tail started wagging the dog. And people who just had a lot of discontent at the banks, because it dovetailed with the AIG bonus scandal, really, it was a failure on the left to articulate a coherent narrative of what was happening with the banks. And so all those people got channeled into the Tea Parties just because, you know, oh yeah, I think that, you know, we shouldn't have
including some
banks.
Of the left?
Huh?
And including, it sounds like you're saying that because the left wasn't articulating it well enough that some on the left actually...
I don't think it's some on the left. I think it's just sort of the great mass of people. I think that's one of the reasons you're seeing independents break 2-1 for the Republicans right now, because we on the left did not articulate that, you know, that narrative. And so people kind of got, ordinary people got swept up in it. So now, you know, you can say, okay, Fox News, Americans for Prosperity, all of these guys, yes, they did get it started. But if you're going to have real change in the country, you've got to be able to speak to people that are breaking towards the Tea Parties that probably are not the extremists that, you know, are out there carrying the signs, and be able to communicate a coherent narrative that is persuasive from the left. And I think that that's one of the problems we're having in this election, is that people don't, you know, people falsely look to the Tea Parties and the Republican Party and say, oh, they're going to, like, rein everybody in. This is going to be fabulous. That's, you know, the idea that Mitt Romney, who's the number one polling candidate for the Tea Parties, the guy from Bain Capital, is going to rein in Wall Street is ludicrous. But, you know, that argument is just not being made.
Carl, you've been around a lot of campaigns. Is this a different movement? Is it different in its scope and its impact than other movements we've seen over the last 30 years?
It is, because it reflects a more widespread, if somehow inarticulated, anger than we've seen. The last time we saw such an outpouring of anger, again, it was articulated to an extent through the right with the Contract for America in the 94 election. But I think something much bigger is going on, and that is that there is both a political and cultural breakdown in this country. It's been going on for 30, 35 years. It has now reached the point of meltdown, especially in the political system, which is broken. I hope not irrevocably, but it might be. The role of money in politics is defining our political system, particularly confirmed by the last Supreme Court decision in the Citizens United case. But more than that, when Jane, and both what Jane and Doug said, and especially about failing to articulate, I think what's happened is that we've failed in this country, particularly the media and the political class generally, especially our elected leaders in both parties, to acknowledge that the system is broken. And because of that failure to start from that premise and to say in our evening news broadcasts, the system is broken, here is why, here is how it happened over a period of 35 years of not dealing with infrastructure, education, medical care, et cetera, et cetera. There is a narrative. There's a truthful narrative. Neither party has embraced or tried to look at the truthful narrative, nor has the press.